welcome you tonight. We're going to get started. A couple of things. Just wanted to ask everyone to go ahead and turn off or turn down your cell phones before we get started. And then we are broadcasting this, so we want to welcome those that are tuning in. If you were not able to get the link to a family member or friend that's out of town, there are some connect cards in front of your seats and also some business cards that'll have the church's website. But they can find that on our YouTube channel, and we'll leave that up there so that others can watch the memorial service. So we want to welcome you tonight to this memorial service to celebrate the life of Ellen Fisk. And, you know, memorial services are very, very powerful, if you think about it. They bring healing, and they bring a lot of closure in our hearts and in our lives. And then it brings a lot of honor to the person that lived their life. And so we're here to honor a wonderful life that was lived. So I want to just pray and give the service to the Lord, and then we'll talk about some things tonight. Lord, we just magnify your name. We thank you that you're the creator of the heavens and the earth. You're the creator of each one of us. And Lord, we dedicate this time to you as we remember Ellen and we celebrate her life. We thank you, Lord, that heaven is a real place and that she is with you right now, rejoicing. And so, Lord, as we remember, as we watch a video, as we talk about some things, Lord, I pray that that would just bring healing in our hearts. And we just thank you for that, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So we want to welcome you this evening. And if you're watching online, we want to welcome you as well. And as we get started, I just want to honor the family that's here. And so present are Don Fletcher and Dempsey and Ruth Fisk and Brenda Fapko and Angela Miller. And so those are her kids and daughter-in-law. And then we have grandchildren, Jessica and Alana Fisk and Colton Clapko and Michelle Miller. And you may have heard little great-grandbaby Cora Clapko is also here. And so we just want to welcome family. And I just think it's really wonderful how you guys were all able to come in and just support one another and be here together. And then we want to honor all of the family that was not able to be here. Ellen had brothers, Alfred Dewey and Gordon Dewey, both in Michigan. And then Robert Dewey lives in Texas. And also some grandchildren that were not able to make it, Samantha and Michelle Fletcher, Justin Powell, and Amber Murphy. And so if you're watching online, we just want to welcome you to the service as well. I want to begin by just reading a scripture out of Psalms, and this is Psalm chapter 100 and verses 1 to 5. It says, "Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations." You know, Ellen entered some gates, and she is in heaven tonight. And one of the greatest things they're doing in heaven right now is worshiping. And I'm going to talk about this in a little bit, but one of the things that I know Ellen just loved to do was worship the Lord. And so we're going to take just a few minutes tonight, and we're going to sing one song, but I think it's apropos, and I just know that she would have wanted us to take a little bit of time to worship. So let's stand to our feet, and we're going to sing this song together. And then after the song, we'll watch our photo memories of Ellen. But I want to encourage you just to worship the Lord. And also, as the Holy Spirit just comes, he's going to touch you. He's going to You're going to feel his presence. Allow him to heal your heart. Allow him to fill those empty places in your heart. And you'll see that God will do something special. So let's worship the Lord together tonight.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord. His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name.
Time has cast a shadow on her memory. An age has robbed her mind of dates and names. Seems the pieces of her past are lost forever, and the old home place just doesn't seem the same. Faded pictures taped into the family album. She tries in vain but can't seem to recall that the handsome man was once her loving husband, who went home to be with Jesus just last fall. But she still remembers Jesus and his amazing grace. He left a mark upon her heart that time cannot erase. She can tell you who he is and what he did and why he came. Yes, she still remembers Jesus' name. Still her children come most days day to see her. Behind their smiles they try to hide their pain, but at times it's hard to keep the tears from coming. When she asked her firstborn child, "Now what's your name?" Yet she knows every word to Rock of Ages' cleft for me. You can feel his presence in the room when she quotes John 3:16. Though she was just a young girl when she first knelt down to pray, she remembers when she met him like it was yesterday. Yes, she still remembers Jesus and his amazing grace. He left a mark upon her heart that time cannot erase. She can tell you who he is and what he did.
So beautiful, so beautiful. How's a great song you guys chose, because that was not easy for you guys to walk through. But one thing she always remembered was the Lord, right? Even if she was forgetting things, she never, never forgot the Lord. You know, Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse 1 says this, that there is a time for everything, and everything on earth has its special season. And so we all go through seasons in life. And every season is actually very, very special, is what the Lord says. And so Ellen was born on February 18th, 1946. And so that was always special to me because I'm a February baby. And so we would talk about our baby. She was born on February 18th, 1946 in Lansing, Michigan. And she grew up there and graduated from Sexton High School in 1964. Got married in June of 1965, and then the next year, Dawn came. You were born. And 2 years later, Dempsey. And then 2 years later, Brenda. And then 2 years later, Angie. How perfect was that? So she had each one of you within 2 years. And right in your neighborhood, there was an Assemblies of God church in Belding, Michigan. And they had a bus ministry. And they started picking up all you kids for Sunday school. And you went to church. And then shortly after that, your mom began to go. And that's where Ellen gave her life to Christ. And shortly after then, her husband, Herb, your dad, began to attend the church as well. And Dempsey told me the other day that she would always wake you guys up by singing Rise and Shine and Give God the Glory, Glory. That's how she would wake you guys up and send you off to school. And then in 1981, she met Paul and Jan Asbill. They came to pastor the church that she was attending in Ionia, Michigan. And Ellen was just a servant. Any of you that really knew her well, she just loved to serve. And so she loved to minister at the altar. And anytime there was a fellowship meal, she was cooking, she was helping clean up, and she was always cleaning the kitchen. And at that time, she cleaned the church, didn't she? She really helped out a lot. Got really close to the Asbills, and then when Paul and Jan moved to Florida in the late 80s, she and her husband moved to Florida as well. And as I said, she just really had a gift to serve. In fact, even the jobs that Ellen had reflected that servant heart. And so in Michigan, she worked in the deli at Lepic's grocery store. And then even when she came down here to Florida, she worked at Publix in the deli. And I started thinking about that, just how that was reflective of her heart to serve. She was always just serving, seemed to always love to give to others. And even at one time, your dad and her had a cleaning business. And so everything she did, if you think about it, was just serving, giving. That was one of her gifts. So fast forward a few years, and she moved back to Michigan and then back to Florida. And we had the privilege of meeting Ellen in 2009 when she began to attend Freedom Church here. And I'll say a few things about Ellen. She just loved to worship the Lord. And that's why I felt it was important for us to just have a song. And I felt like that song, 10,000 Reasons, was so appropriate for us to worship. And, you know, we need to always praise the Lord and thank Him for the good things. And so she just loved the Lord. She just loved to worship. And she always just loved the Word of God. In fact, she was always asking me, Pastor, can I get your sermon on CD? Where's the last sermon? I want to get that on CD. She just loved the Word of God. She would listen to messages over and over. She loved the move of the Holy Spirit. Anytime that we would have ministry time here at the altar, she was there receiving. She just always wanted more of the presence of the Lord. And that just blessed me beyond beyond words. And as I said, she just loved to serve. So here at our church, she was always serving. In fact, for years, she and Jan faithfully cleaned the church. So faithful. And so this was just her gift. She just loved to do that. Anytime that we would have a fellowship meal, again, she was back at the kitchen and helping cleaning up. So that was one of the hallmarks of her life. And then she would tell us about you guys. And so she would tell us all about her kids and all of her grandkids. And I think we kind of had a special affinity because Dempsey and I are the same age. And so I had to be a spiritual son while you were in Washington. And so, and then because I have four kids, she had four kids. And so I think there was a connection there. She was always so kind and so interested in our children. And I know that she just missed you grandkids so much and wished that she could live around you guys and be around you. And so she was always interested in the kids, in the youth. Anytime the youth would go on a mission trip, she was always so interested in what was happening. And our youth here at the church really loved her. In fact, they went out to her house a couple of times and did work on the house and fixed up the house and worked in the yard. In fact, our men's ministry did that as well. And it was such a pleasure. It was such a joy. I don't know if I'm the only one, but I noticed she likes to tell jokes. She really enjoyed jokes. Now, here's the thing about Ellen is she was a literalist. No metaphors, at least in my experience. There was no metaphor. So, for example, and this happened all the time, probably on a weekly basis, she'd come in and they'd be cleaning here at the church and I would have to go run an errand. And I'd say, oh, I got to run to the bank or run an errand. But she would always say, well, I wouldn't do that. That's an awful long way to run. That was her standard line. She just, no metaphors. I wouldn't do that. That's an awful long way, she would say. So she just had a great sense of humor. She loved to laugh. She just loved to laugh. In fact, Jan was telling me that if they were driving by some cows, her favorite line was beef on hoof. Beef on hoof. And that's what she would always say. So she just loved to laugh. She also enjoyed games, playing cards. In fact, a group of ladies in our church, you guys would get together once a week and play games and have lunch together. And I think, Brenda, you joined them after you moved down here as well. So those are just really special memories. One thing I noticed, and you kids can verify this, but she just loved going out to eat. She really enjoyed going out to eat. And so for us, one of my favorite ministry memories is that with the cleaning ministry, we would make it a regular habit to go to Sonny's. And she just loved barbecue. Now, she had the menu memorized. She wouldn't even have to look at the menu. She would know exactly what she wants. And Jan, her buddy, you guys, you already knew. And then you would split everything, the things she liked and the things you liked. And they just had it memorized. But that was a lot of fun. We would just go and we would fellowship and just have a great time. And one special memory I have is when she and Jan took us to Maggiano's. And that was just so special. That is hard to receive. But when somebody has a gift to serve, that's one of their ways that they love to do that. Isn't that special? I was talking to Brenda and to Dawn and to Angie and to Dempsey, and they shared with me that one of her favorite verses was Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your paths straight. And so the other day when we were talking, you guys said this. She had a continuous and steadfast faith in Jesus. And that's why we can rejoice in her joining Jesus in heaven. I'm going to read that to you again because that's what you guys wrote to me and sent me. But I want everyone to hear that again. So her kids said this. She had a continuous and steadfast faith in Jesus. And that is why we can rejoice in her joining Jesus in heaven. She's been promoted. Can you say amen? And I had the privilege of being with her the night before she went to heaven. And Brenda called me. Don, you had come in town. The rest of you hadn't gotten here yet. But you called me and I said, well, I'll come up in the morning. And she shared with me that there probably just wasn't going to be that much more time. I said, well, I'll come in the morning. And I hung up the phone and I felt that urgency. And I felt something. And I called Brenda right back. I said, can I come up? I just feel like I'm supposed to come up tonight. And so I went up and went into the nursing home and just talked. And, you know, of course, at that point, she wasn't able to communicate or anything, but she followed me with her eyes. And I believe in my heart. We don't know at this point, but I believe that she knew. She knew it was me. And I just told her, I said, Ellen, I love you. We're going to miss you, but I'll see you soon. I'll see you in heaven. And I think she just needed to hear that. And then it was early the next morning, I think, that she went on to be with the Lord. And I just want you to know that Ellen was ready. She was ready, and she was wanting. In fact, we talked, and we said, Lord, if you don't heal her, it's a gift to take her home. Amen. And so she has been promoted, and we celebrate that. Normally, at this time in the service, I always like to give family an opportunity to share. But understandably, they have said they just want to cry. And so would that be okay, church, if they just cry? And I don't know if I could share either. And so they have a lot of wonderful memories and honoring their mom. I want to read a scripture for you guys tonight in light of Ellen's life. I think this will be a blessing to you. This is out of John chapter 14, and I just want to read the first 7 verses. And I want to talk to you just for a few minutes. You've heard about Ellen's life, and we talked about how much she loved the Lord. She loved the Word of God. How much she loved to serve the Lord. I want to talk to you for a few minutes just about the reliability of God. Jesus said this in John 14, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me." You know, it's understandable if you're feeling troubled tonight. Because when you love someone, when you rely on somebody, you know, there's no one that can replace a mom. Nobody. There's nobody that she was there when you were born. There's no one that can have the wisdom or even the strength. And so it would be understandable if our hearts are troubled tonight. Or maybe you're here tonight and she was a close friend, a family member. It's understandable, but God says here, trust me, trust me, trust me, he's saying. And then he says this, in my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. Notice the language that Jesus uses. He says, I'm going to prepare a place. That's a physical place. It's a real place. It's a room. The original text, the Greek, speaks of hoikos. It's a house. So he's preparing a place. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you with me that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. And Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way? And Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. And so I want to talk about the reliability of God, because life is so fleeting. And so we can't rely on money. We can't rely on things. We can't rely on a career. We can't even always rely on our health. We can take care of ourselves. And we can't even rely on people all the time. People come and go, and people encourage us, but sometimes they disappoint. We're so human, but God is so, so reliable. And so the first thing I just want to encourage us tonight is we're remembering and we're just having some time to talk and to pray together, is first remember the good. Drill down on the good. Think about the good things. And that's really important in life, is to look back. That's why that video was so important. Pull out the pictures and remember the good times. You might be here tonight and regretting that you didn't have as much time, or regretting that you lived a long ways away. Listen, it's okay. Just remember the good time and focus on the fact that heaven is a real place. Heaven is a real place. So remember the good. Philippians 1:3 says this, I thank my God every time I remember you. And so I know today is a mixture of emotions. I'm emotional. My heart is missing Ellen. I think back to all these times that we shared, and that's understandable. But I thank God for the times that we had together. And I thank God that she left an imprint on my heart, and she left an imprint on the people in our church, and she left an imprint on her family and on her friends. And so we thank God when we remember her, and we remember the good. We remember the good times. The second thing is this: receive God's comfort. Receive his comfort. And so Jesus said this in John 16, "You are filled with grief, but I will send the counselor or the comforter to you." And so yeah, we grieve, we cry, and we should grieve. That's normal and that's healthy. But Jesus said, "I'm going to send the Holy Spirit, and he's going to comfort you." So no one can fill that place, that space that only Ellen could fill. Only your mom, only your grandma could fill. No one can fill that space. But what God promises is he sends his Holy Spirit, and he fills that place with his presence and with his peace. And so you're going to have all kinds of things that trigger. You'll probably be just driving. Something will happen. You'll remember, and you'll just start crying. Keep crying. Just cry. Just keep walking one step at a time. But in that moment, the Holy Spirit comes to comfort. And he's going to remind you. He'll fill that place with peace and with his presence. And he'll remind you that you get to see her again one day. Amen? And so receive the comfort of the Lord. And the third thing is this, is rejoice in the reward. Rejoice that she went to heaven. Heaven is a real place. This is the difference between Christianity and every other religion, that we're assured, we have an assurance of salvation, that heaven is a real place. Jesus spoke of a physical place here. And so we can rejoice in the reward that she's there with the Lord. And so the scripture that you sent me was the one in Revelation that there are no tears in heaven. There are no sicknesses. Even though Ellen was struggling at the end, and it was heartbreaking because she couldn't remember. And I know, Brenda, you just struggled. Because how do you deal with that when mom isn't remembering or isn't acting the way she acted before? But notice this, when she gets to heaven and she's there now, her mind is completely clear. Total healing. No more physical pain. No more mental anguish. And the Bible says this, that when we get to heaven, right now we know in part, but then we will know fully. In other words, we'll have the full capacity of our minds to know the Lord completely. And so Ellen is unhindered today. She has seen the Lord face to face, and she's rejoicing. And heaven is not just something, when you study heaven in the scripture, it's not like people floating on clouds. And heaven is a real place. Jesus talked about a house. So she's going to have a house to live in. The Bible talks about a great marriage supper of the Lamb. I know she's going to like that. She's going to enjoy that. In fact, even Jesus, when he resurrected, remember, he ate with the disciples. He was in his glorified bodies, but he ate with the disciples. So we get to eat up there. That's pretty cool. We get to have a place to live. That's pretty cool. We get to know the Lord. We get to worship. We get to have relationship without the sinful nature, without any insecurities, without any hang-ups, without any of our own stuff that gets in the way. Can you imagine having just clear relationships without any of that? That's where Ellen is right now. It's wonderful. It's glorious. And the Bible is clear that when we get there, that this life is just the beginning. So all of her serving here, there are rewards. I know in my heart that Jesus looked at her and said, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." And so heaven is a real place. We look to the reward of heaven. And this is one of the most encouraging and strengthening truths that we have as believers. And it gives us hope, and it gives us peace. And so rejoice in the reward. Listen to this scripture, 2 Timothy 4 and verses 7 to 8. "I have fought the fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. And so Ellen finished her race, and she kept the faith to the end. Yeah, when I heard that song, I had never heard that song before. But when I heard that song, it touched me, because it's true. To the end, she knew Jesus. Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that powerful? She finished her race. She kept the faith to the end. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. And so Ellen has an amazing reward, but you and I can also have the reward of heaven and of being with Christ. So remember the good, receive God's comfort, rejoice in the reward, and finally, refocus on eternity. You know, memorials, funerals are a good time for us to refocus our priorities and to refocus on eternity. Jesus said, hey, you guys know where I'm going and you know the way. Thomas wasn't sure. He says, Lord, how can we know the way? We're not even sure. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. In other words, there's only one way to get to heaven, and that's through Christ. In John chapter 10 and verse 9, Jesus spoke metaphorically, and he says this, I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. And so there's only one way to get to heaven, and that's through Christ. Truth, by definition, is exclusive. There aren't many ways. There's only one door. There's only one gate. And that's through Christ. And so we all want to see Ellen again, or we wouldn't be here. You're either a family member or a very good friend. But there's only one way to see Ellen again, and that's to go through the gate of salvation, which is the gate of Christ. And so we want to give you that opportunity. It's a great time at a memorial service, not just to remember, not just to be healed, but also to refocus for eternity and to ask yourself, do I know for sure that I'm on my way to heaven? And so some of you, I don't know if you'll, this might be the only time we can get you in church. But we want to give you that opportunity to give your life to Christ. And I know Ellen would have asked me to do that, to say, hey, I want to see these guys again. And the only way to do it is to give your life to Christ. You know, we've heard that Jesus is the Savior of the world. Most people have heard that. But it all comes down to, have I asked Jesus to be my Savior? Have I asked him to be my personal Savior? And that's when I ask God to forgive me for my sins. I ask Jesus to be my Savior. That's why he died on the cross. And I give my life to him, and I walk through that gate of salvation. Folks, if you do that, then you'll have the assurance that you're going to see Ellen again. Can you say amen, church? And so I want to give you that opportunity. And so I'm just going to ask you to close your eyes just for a moment. This is really important. And I know Ellen would really want us to do this. But if you're here tonight and you're not sure that if you were to die tonight that you would go to heaven, I want to give you that opportunity and just pray a simple prayer with you. So right here in the privacy of where you are, what a great time to refocus on eternity. And so if you would like to commit your heart to Christ tonight, all you have to do is just look up and make eye contact with me. And then I'll know that that's what you want to do. And God will know that. Now, you already might have done this and you might be living for the Lord. But if tonight you say, I would like to do that, then I want to give you that opportunity. So I'm going to start on my left, which is your right. And I'm going to start just looking across the building here. And if you want to do that, just look up at me. Is that what you're doing? And just eye contact with me. Yeah. Feels good, doesn't it? Doesn't that feel good? Now I'm in the middle section. Is that what you're doing? That feels good, doesn't it? Yeah. And now I'm looking on my right, which is the far left side. And if you would like to do that, doesn't that feel good? Just commit in your heart. God knows. He knows exactly what you're committing to. Yeah. I'm just going to pray this simple prayer, and as I pray it, I want you to just repeat it in your mind along with me as a commitment to the Lord. Jesus, we thank you for dying on the cross. You are the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except through Christ. And you said that you're the door, you're the gate to heaven. And tonight, Lord, we ask you to forgive us for our sin. We ask you to be our personal Savior. We give our lives to you, the best that we know how, to follow you. And we thank you, Lord, that we will see Ellen again because she's waiting in heaven. And we give you praise for that. In Jesus' name, amen. Can you say amen tonight? Yeah. So be encouraged. Heaven is a real place. That's one of the greatest, most comforting things that we have as believers tonight. Yeah. So we want to thank you guys for coming. I'm going to pray for the family. And I just want to pray for comfort. And I want to pray for any needs that you guys might have too. You know, there's a lot of decisions to make. So you guys keep these guys in prayer. They have a lot of pressure. But I know that God is going to help them. And so our families up front, with the rest of you, just every church has their culture. So those of you that are in our church, would you just stretch your hands forward to them symbolically, and we'll pray for them tonight. Lord, we thank you so much for this precious family. Lord, Ellen has left a legacy. And Lord, tonight I just pray for comfort. I pray for peace. I pray for strength. And Lord, I pray for provision for them, that you would supply for all of their needs. Lord, that you would give them wisdom as they talk about things. And we just pray blessing on generations, on kids, as well as grandkids and great-grandkids. We give you the praise for that in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Well, we want to thank you tonight for coming to remember Ellen Fisk. What a beautiful life. And so the family has invited us to just have a time of fellowship. We're going to go next door, and we just have some wonderful dessert. Some of you, I understand, bake some goods, and so we look forward to that. And I just want you guys to encourage them. Listen, one thing that's important is don't feel like you have to have words. Just hug someone. We don't always have words. Just hug them. Just say, we love you. But reach out to them tonight. Encourage them. And then some of you that know them and have their numbers, reach out a little later. Because sometimes it hits hard. It's hard afterwards. And so continue to reach out for them. And so we want to encourage you to fellowship. There was a book to sign, a guest book, and some encouraging notes to fill out. We're going to take that over to the fellowship room so that if you didn't have an opportunity to do that, you can sign it maybe as you're leaving, or then if you go over, we'll have it there. All right? So God bless you, and we thank you for coming too.